it's a fun kind of job. It's half-time doing this patentability stuff, and part of my compensation is access to their umbrella of their distribution company. So it's like taxes, all this other stuff, warehouse space, so I can start like another company kind of half-time with that. So it's
okay.
It's kind of a dual hat fun kind
of. Ooh, yeah, just one person came in. It's great we've got a number of new people tonight. So welcome to Rocky Mountain Inventors. It's a nonprofit educational organization. So we're not here to sell you anything. We do presentations twice monthly on all kinds of topics, funding, finance. We have entrepreneurs come in and we do manufacturing, prototyping, 3D printing, legal, marketing, promotion, social media. And we're also always open to suggestions. We have local presenters, and we also do Skype presenters, so we can get people from around the country that have expertise in various areas, say like Asian manufacturing, or another one like how to get into Home Depot type stores or whatever, you know, so you know what's going on in those areas. So anyway, we basically work to help you not make mistakes and not get ripped off. And so some of that is from networking and learning from each other. And other things is to, you know, just get you information that you might need in whatever area. Okay. What we usually do is give everybody a little bit of a confidentiality warning. You know, if you're not patent pending or haven't already publicly disclosed, keep your idea secret so you preserve your trade secret status on it. You can maybe talk a little bit about the function of it, but not the detail topics there. So anyway, I'm Roger Jackson. I'm on the board. Been in this group since 99. The group's been around since 78 in a lot of different forms over the years. I'm a patent attorney by day. So you can certainly feel free to hit me up with legal questions related to that. We usually just do a round robin, give everyone about a minute, and introduce yourself and why you're here, what you're looking for, what you got going on. So let's start with you, Sean.
Hey, I'm Sean Flickinger. I'm an industrial designer or a product designer. I deal with usually the beginning of a product development process, new ideas,
are you looking to help people with designs? You have your own, or?
Well, we have our own, but we help other people with their designs.
Okay.
And I'm
patent office now downtown, so they come and present to us about once a quarter on various topics. Okay, Evan?
My name's Evan Brown, and I'm primarily just here to learn. It's my first time I've been to a meeting, and I've been racking up ideas over the years, a lot of them related to the bicycle industry, which is largely my background, but some surreptitious to that as well. And I don't know where to go with it, and I haven't seen them to fruition in whatever form they take, so I'm here to learn.
Okay, good, yeah, you're in the right place. It's a competitive industry. We've had people before with bicycle-related products. Okay, Jim.
Jim. I'm just an inventor, first time here. I've worked for 5 years to create a product and ready to market, and I've done the non-provisional application and provisional. I'm waiting to hear back from the examiner for the...
So you're waiting for your first office action?
Yeah.
How long has it been in?
3 months.
Okay, so it's probably going to be...
No,
could be another year.
Yes.
Unless you accelerated it.
That's one question I have. Someone said if you're over 65, they accelerate.
Yeah, you... Yeah, that's a special petition,
right.
So... That puts you on the top of the pile, but it doesn't guarantee a time frame. So if examiner has all other specials, then you're not prioritized over others. You can pay extra to get accelerated, but for most people, a longer patent pending is a good thing because it gives you more time to kind of get out and get your manufacturing and market figured out, and you get protection, and it delays expenses into the future, issue fees, maintenance fees, and stuff. So sometimes, I mean, most of the time I think long patent pendency is good, unless you're in a big hurry to know if you're going to get a patent or not, you got a licensing deal pending or something. Don?
Don, Don McGray. Say pro guard, invent an easy ladder cardio, reduce ladders from slipping and falling on boats, introduced a bill into legislation last year, and it was a hornet's nest pretty much, but got a lot of feedback, and got the attention of AFL-CIO, Ocean, a lot of organizations like that. So moving forward this year, we should have a resolution now issued to us probably in the next couple months, which will be huge. So that's kind of what we're wondering now.
Good.
Now I got a patent still out there, but it's on there.
Yeah.
For what, the last 30 minutes now? It's getting pretty old.
Tim?
My name's Tim Nichols. Really just have some ideas and kind of trying to figure out where I'm going to go with them. Most of my ideas deal with child safety.
Okay. And Sheldon?
Just here to learn. I've got all kinds of, solved all kinds of problems. Keep them in here for now, but I'm ready to know where to go with them. I'm a sculptor by trade. I've raised a family, paid off a home, paid off another home, all in art, but I've been kind of like Da Vinci, more of a scientific artist. And when problems arise, I solve them and make them more simple. So
okay.
It's constantly flowing, so I got to learn how to move them through the system so that we can let them help other people too.
Yeah, yeah. Now, I mentioned that if you have an idea, it doesn't really have a legal existence yet unless it's strapped down by a contract or a patent.
Right.
Okay. So when you're in that phase of the idea, you're a trade secret, so you're fragile legally.
Yeah.
So that's why you have to keep it confidential.
Right.
And if you're not patent pending and you use, say, confidentiality agreements with people, that's your contract part.
Right.
Okay, so you've given it some sort of existence. But in the idea phase, it's like nobody owns it and everybody owns it.
Right.
It's the public. If you disclose it to the public, you've given it to them.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anyway, I'll introduce our speaker. It's Adam Zimmer. He previously worked at the US Patent Office. Was it Alexandria?
That was in the Denver office.
Denver office, okay. And so he's here to give us some inside exposure, I guess, to what the patent office examiners do and what they look for and like to see and not like to see in the process. So it's a great perspective because we've always just had, you know, patent office people. And of course, I think you're probably freer to talk.
Yeah,
well, than they are.
I'm not a fashionable.
Yeah. So I'll go ahead and let you start.
Sure. Thanks, Roger. Like Roger said, I'm a former patent examiner for the PTO. I worked out of the Denver office, worked there for about a year. While I was there, I was doing mechanical utility patent prosecution. So my particular art unit was guns and ammunition. So that's the very narrow scope that I would actually look at. And as I go through my presentation, you'll kind of see how that plays in, this concept of art units. Currently, I'm doing patent engineering work, which that's, you got patent engineer, where that's just the person that's working on patents for you. Then you have a patent agent, which has the ability to go through the prosecution process with you. And then you have patent attorney, which can go outside of the PTO for legal matters as well. So that's kind of the structure of IP help. So I'll just kind of move forward and go Broncos.
Yeah.
Hoorah. So this is just kind of an overview of what I'm going to talk about today. Go over the core, who they are, and how they fit in the PTO, what their responsibilities are, what they do day to day inside the black box, kind of the differences in between individual examiners, because there are a lot. And how you can help your examiner. It really is a partnership. You know, when you start working a case with an examiner, they're gonna take that case through prosecution, and then if you have follow-on continuation of parts, they're also gonna do those. So you'll see their name a lot if you start working with them. And then I just got a big list of helpful resources for you guys as pro ses that might give you some help, give you some insight. So the core, the organization is basically, the PTO has five offices. You have the Alexandria main office, and then you have four satellites that are throughout the country, and one right here in Denver, so we're pretty lucky. You have the director of, when it comes to the actual breakdown of these units, and the breakdown of the prior art and how these examiners handle it, you've got the director kind of running the ship. You've got supervisory patent examiners of different varieties. You have a standard SPE, which that's the supervisor for probationary examiners and examiners that don't have full signatory authority. Basically, they're the supervisors. And in that bucket, you also have resource supervisory patent examiners, which are jack of all trades type people that will deal with all of mechanical, you know, all of electrical. And then finally, you've got the examiner core. And those are the people that are actually doing the examination of your patent. So that's the person that's going to be signing that office action, unless they're, you know, having their supervisor sign it for them. However, all the supervisor is doing is reviewing their actions that they send out and make sure that they're proper. And then finally, you've got the legal instrument examiners. And what their job is all the admin stuff to make sure that you guys are paying the fees on time, that your drawings are clear. That you're meeting all the laws and rules that you need to do from an admin standpoint. And then the STIC, that's the Scientific and Technical Instrumentation. I can't quite remember the acronym, but basically they're a technical resource for examiners. So when they're doing their prosecution, their examination, taking your patent and seeing if it applies to prior art, they might contact the STIC to help them figure out how to search a particular claim. They might, you know, talk to the STIC about what technology is relevant in the field. So they're just kind of a helpful resource for examiners that they use. And they actually use it quite sparingly, unfortunately. When it comes down to actually the examiner core, how it's broken down is it goes really far down into really specific bandwidth of technology. So for an art unit, you're gonna have about 15 people. That's what we had, and I was in art unit 3641 there. We were doing all ammunition, explosives, guns, basically anything that was an explosive. And so we had quite a few classifications. And just to backtrack just slightly, all patents are
all technologies are fit inside of a particular classification category. And so there's a lot of different types of classifications, but the U.S. is going more towards the CPC, which is the cooperative patent classification, and getting away from the old style system of just the U.S.-based classification. And that's just to find, you know, common ground, because there's so much intellectual property that's international. So we need a classification source that's common so that we can all use it. And then that's just another example. Our unit 3721 does package making, tool driving, and driving members, so hammers, things like that. And I didn't work in there, so I don't know specifically what those things mean, but you can see the definitions online. For the examiners themselves, like individually, their background is basically just tech competence. They have to have gone to an engineering school or have the you know, required experience to get certified as that. And the PTO vets the people that come in and become examiners very, very thoroughly. And there's a very intense probationary period where they make sure that they're going to do a good job at good speed and you know, provide the you inventors with good intellectual property. They vary in age and nationality, so a lot of foreigners are working these things because we need technical experts in semiconductors, and there's a lot of foreign folks with good semiconductor technical backgrounds. So when they see your patent application, they're going to have a knowledge of the state of the art, and that's why they got hired. Me personally, I was in the military for a long time and did a lot of testing on guns and weapon systems and explosives, so when I got accepted in the examination corps, that's where they put me. And then you're going to have, when it comes to the training that they get and how good they are, you're going to have a mix of folks that went to the Patent Training Academy, which is kind of a new thing, and I can't remember how many years ago it started, but basically it's a formal education program for the examiners, and nowadays it's a four-month, eight-hour-day training session with a very heavy, handed supervisory follow-up for, you know, 8 months after that. And then after a year, they get off probation and they go into the actual examination corps. So that's just kind of a breakdown of what it looks like. So when you send in your application, it's going to go in there and it goes to that guy, the examiner, or that girl. And so moving along. So the responsibilities, they're going to look at your disclosure. Disclosure is your entire application as a whole. So you got your specification, your drawings, your claim sets. So they're going to look through those drawings, make sure your numbers line up, make sure that the spelling's okay, make sure that it makes sense, and object to any issues that they see. They're going to do prosecution as well, and that's where they're going to determine your eligibility and if your subject matter is allowable. So they're going to put it against the U.S. laws and rules to make sure, well, in this case, U.S. laws 101, to make sure that it's an eligible it's an eligible subject, and then with the allowable subject matter, that's more towards looking at the prior art, the other inventions out there, and doing a comparison. So they're going to determine, they're going to interpret those claims based on guidance from the USPTO, and that's in what's called the Manual of Patent Examination Procedures. And so they're going to just take guidance from the USPTO and apply it towards looking at your claims and also looking at the prior art that's out there, and realizing how, based on guidance from the USPTO, how prior art is allowed to be applied to against your patent, basically. And like I said, the USPTO provides all this stuff, and the USPTO provides all that information to you, too. Granted, it's not in a nice training seminar. It's not given to you in a training seminar, so it's a little bit harder to stomach, but that information is available if you can find the time and not fall asleep while you're reading it. And then finally, kind of the last step is delivering actions from the office. So what an office action is essentially is to put the ball back in your court. So when the ball's back in your court, timelines start. So I throw it back to you, you got 6 months, you gotta get a response back to me, or else you're gonna lose that patent. You gotta get it to me, and I've got a docket management system that I gotta get back to you. So I'm fighting clocks, and you're fighting clocks. And the goal is, you know, be timely and get the ball out of your court as quickly as you can. That's the best practice. for actions, compact prosecution is a really important theme when it comes to an examiner writing an action. And when I say action, it's a little bit nebulous. An action is basically, you know, you send your application to me, I'm going to do a first action on merits where I look at, is this eligible matter? Like, is it one of the four categories of invention that's patentable? Those being composition of material, a machine, process, and what's the fourth one? I can't quite remember what the fourth one is, but you can just look it up online. Go to the USPTO and just say, you know, eligible invention subject matter or something like that. But anyway, with these actions, you know, when they respond to you, whatever the wherever they are in the prosecution cycle, whether it's your first action getting back to you, a second action after you made an amendment, or you know, a final response, or really any time they're sending something out, it's going to be in the form of an action. So examiners, it's really pressed on them to get as much information into that response to you guys, into that action as possible. So they're going to go through and they're going to do every type of rejection under the sun, every type of objection under the sun. They're going to do restriction analysis. And I know these terms are a little bit foreign to y'all, but you know, they're going to do everything they can and just completely be done with this, send the ball back in your court, and give you a chance to respond to every single one of those. And so what that does is it really increases the efficiency of these actions so that you guys can get through this process a lot quicker. And then finally, with these actions, they have to present basically a sufficient supporting evidence to make a case, okay? So that's really important. So the clarity in their actions, you know, when I say that your piece of art is, you know, the same as this piece of art, I need to give you enough information so you can understand my point of view and where I'm coming from and what evidence I'm using to support that. And if they don't do that sufficiently, you know, that's grounds for appeal. But that's another topic altogether. So day to day, this is what an examiner does. We're going to use these tools. As an examiner, I use every one of those tools every single day. Palm is your central all things patent repository. So when I have an application, it's going to have access to all the documentations that you guys send back to us. It's going to have all your inventor information. I can click on your name and I can see what other inventions you've made. And it's just basically all things from that application. And I have a docket of, say, 25 applications that I'm watching. So that all that information is in one resource. PE2E is a new software out there. It's a case management software. It's the same information that's in Palm, but it's in just a different format so that examiners can more clearly see their timelines, when things are due, if they're going to go past the deadline, because that has big ramifications on their paycheck, actually. We have OATS, and that's just basically Word with a bunch of macros, so that we're able to, or examiners are able to, when they're typing out their office action, they can pull in what's called form paragraphs from this repository. And a form paragraph is basically the cookie cutter statement for any particular part of law or rules from the PTO, and it makes it so the examiner doesn't have to reinvent the wheel and type everything. It's basically just cookie cutter things that we're going to insert into this action so that you know what law this came from, you know, and some basic information. And then the examiner should actually follow up after that and add in additional information to make it more clear. So that's just a time-saving tool. And then we have templates for everything that we write, whether it's an action or it's an 892, if you're familiar with that, which is your references cited by the examiner. So basically, every form that you're ever going to get from us is a template. And when we get it, we're going to open it up and we're going to start filling out stuff. So if you see a box isn't checked, that's what happened. East and West, those are the search tools. People really don't use West. It's a web-based version of East. It's not as easy to use. East is a really powerful search tool. You can burn through applications, especially if you're doing mechanical stuff, because you can look at pictures at a really fast rate. But it is a
bit harder to master than something like Google Patents that has nice algorithms that, that use common English to figure things out. Then I'd use third-party tools like IP.com. These are just other search tools that focus more on different types of technology. So if I'm not finding something specific, I can use a different resource and maybe hit it from a different angle and try to find other pieces of art that are out there. And they're actually pretty useful. And the big thing about them is they have better algorithms than, say, East. With East, you have to be very deliberate on how you do this, on how you do your searching. With third-party tools, it's a lot like Google search. You can type in what your invention is, and it'll do automatically look for synonyms, and it'll find other art for you inside and outside of patents. And then the stick, like I said, those are just examiner technological search help. For the day, my major efforts that are going to utilize all that stuff, first and foremost, I've got docket management. So the way that it works for an examiner is I'm going to carry a docket of, say, 25 to 50 patents, and they're all different types of patents. They're either going to be, and not different in the sense of a utility versus the design, I purely do utility. So I'm going to have, you know, 15 cases that are new cases. I'm going to have 5 cases that are amendments. I'm going to have 5 cases that are special new cases, and I'm going to have, you know, 4 other ones that are of a different flavor. And basically, each one of those different actions has a different count. And what the count is basically, if you're an examiner, you have this type of technology, it should take you this many hours to get a case fully prosecuted, and that's called a balance disposal rate. So like me, I was in guns and ammo. Every guns and ammo patent supposedly has around 18 hours for me to do a full prosecution on that case. Based on that, the 18-hour window of doing it all, the first action on merits, which is the hardest thing to do, because that's when you do your prior art search, that's when you really check it for eligibility, you really get a lot of stuff out of the way with that first one, that's worth 1.25 counts, okay? And say it has it's 12 hours for me to do it. The second action might be is worth 0.25 counts. And then a disposal where this thing is completely done with, that's 0.5 counts. So for each case, you get 2 counts, you get a certain amount of time to do it, and they break down the points that you get of those 2 points for each of the parts of that process. And so you have to, that just gives you some insight into when it comes to the examiner corps, we have to meet a certain quota each bi-week to make sure that we, and I'm saying we as in like the proverbial sense, they need to have, specifically for me, I had to do about 4 first actions and 2 amendments per bi-week. Every 2 weeks I'd have to kick out that much work in order for me to meet the 100% productivity that I needed. And if I go below that, there's a huge ramification on retention when you're in probationary period. And then there's a really complex bonus structure that's built into how people manage their dockets. So if you're terrible at managing your docket and you have cases busting your timelines, then you're going to lose a bunch of money as an examiner. So anyway, that's just something to keep in mind. And so if you feel like you're being put on the back burner, you might be. Because if they have 5 special new cases, those get priority and those have a very tight deadline. And so I'm gonna push everything else back on my docket. So you can see how it just kind of leads to how they prioritize and, you know, trying to get this many counts. So I have to do a first action this bi-week, and I'm not going to do an amendment because I need more counts than that. So you can see how it plays a role in how they prioritize, a huge role.
Is this why you're not there?
Actually, it was.
I wouldn't be there anymore.
It is a very stressful thing, and it's especially on quick turn cases. It's if you have a low BD, which guns and ammo is, it's an aggressive amount of work to accomplish. Especially because if your work gets kicked back and you have to redo something, essentially the examiner's redoing a lot of the process. So you can really get stuck. But anyway, then they're going. So that's the first thing is they're managing the docket on a daily basis. They're doing evaluations on merits on a daily basis, looking at claim interpretation, doing art searches, applying, you know, BRI, broadest reasonable interpretation, and modifications for rejection, so that's standard stuff you think of. Responding to arguments from attorneys and pro se inventors, so it's a lot of response interpretation, and you're also conducting interviews, things like that. And then finally, writing and delivering your office action. So you have art-based and non-art-based. It's just everything coming out of that office, the examiner, that one person is producing all that stuff. So just recognize that is one guy doing everything. So have a good rapport with them. Sure.
On that, say, typical 18 hours.
Mm-hmm.
So what would be like your split up for search versus doing an office action and other stuff?
So with my BD, if it was about 18, I would typically use about 12 hours for the first action. Of that first action, I was doing probably a 5 to 6 hour search, 4 hours to write up, and then 2 hours of cleanup and questions and stuff like that. So, yeah, about, yeah, and the write up is pretty intensive too, especially if you have a lot of issues that are non art related, like 112s and objections, and that can really suck up your time. So, the fewer of those you can have, the better product you'll get from a search perspective. So any other questions?
How is this communication between myself and you going, or the attorney and you? Like, how is the, is it physical mail? Is it what is?
It's going to be digital, and pretty much everything's going to be in writing.
Okay.
Even if we have an interview, I'm going to write an interview summary that puts down everything we talked about. They're going to have, when it comes to a case, they want to have everything they can, all the information possible in that case record.
Right.
And so there's not, over the phone we might talk, but that's about the only time that there's gonna be information lost. Everything else is gonna be in writing. So, when it comes to who they deal with, if you have a lawyer, they're gonna deal with a lawyer. If it's just an inventor, they're just gonna deal with that inventor. So unless you've, you know, signed off your legal right for them to talk to somebody else. But they're going to do a single point of contact, so there's not inventor saying this, lawyer saying that. We're going to talk to whoever that application data sheet says to talk to. That's who we're going to talk to. Okay, some idiosyncrasies between examiners. So you have to, you know, the examiner corps is very broad. Different cultures, different people, different arts, different ways to look at it depending on your art. And so just to kind of let you know that exists. It's not a perfect system. And there's a million ways to look at a set of prior art and apply it to a rejection of an application. You asked 4 different examiners how they would reject a claim, and you're gonna get 4 different answers on how they're gonna do it. So it's subjective, but it's objective in the way that they apply the art. And the fact that they're gonna make a prima facie case of obviousness, or, you know, they're going to give you the information necessary to prove from their point of view that this is, you know, proper, this rejection is proper, or this restriction is proper. They're going to give you the evidence. So, but it's all different between these people. Time is money. So one of the big things is, you know, when you get stuff back from the patent office, speed is so important there. It's very stressful, you get a lot to do, there's a lot to, in the course of, in prosecuting a patent, there's a lot of stuff that we have to look at. And so it's kind of the general rule of thumb is, we're gonna do our best we can in the time we have allotted, and that's the product you're gonna get from the office. So I don't have 50 hours to review a specification and find all the drawing numbers that you messed up. I don't have time for that. I'm gonna look at your claim set, I'm gonna scan your specification if I need to out of the claim set, but for the most part, I'm not looking at that specification and drawings. I'm looking at your claims. If your claims are confusing, then I go to your specification and drawings to try to figure it out. If I go to your specification and drawings and your things don't make sense, that's the only time I'm gonna flag it in the office action. Okay, so it's really important that you do a good job of getting a specification that has sufficient information and is sufficiently clear. Because because you might not get that cleaned up by the examiner.
Do you feel 18 hours is like a minimally adequate amount of time?
I think that for purely claim interpretation, I think that it's sufficient. When it comes to going into your specification and making sure that it makes sense.
The spec all agree, but it isn't going enough.
Yeah, it's a real invention that's not nonsensical, that, you know, I shouldn't apply one of them. So you won't see a lot of one-on-one rejections when it comes to mechanical stuff. They're just going to assume that this makes sense. You know, when I was doing it, you know, I was a lot more detail-oriented, so I was flagging stuff that, you know, if you pull that chain that way, the gear spins like that, not like that, and therefore this machine doesn't work. So I would flag that for 101, but usually they won't do that. You're just going to see 102, 103, 112s, and then maybe some claim objections and maybe a few spec objections if they catch them while they're going through the process. So the application prior art rejection, so broadest reasonable interpretation, that's kind of the guiding light when it comes to applying art in a rejection. So if I go out there and I look at your claim set and it says, you know, a protrusion coming off the top surface, you know, my idea of what a protrusion is subjective, but to me, broadest reasonable interpretation, a bunch of bumps for grip, to provide texture to grip, that to me is not a projection. That to me is a textured surface. That's roughed, or that's, you know, some other synonym that's related to that. Protrusion is a single monolithic structure of any shape. It could be a cylinder, it could be a square, it doesn't matter, but it needs to be a protrusion. And so that's how I would view that. A different examiner might view a textured surface as a protrusion. And one of those textured bumps is your protrusion that will fall out. Which they're, you know, right saying that technically, but you know, you can take that to court, you know, and say, hey, it's unreasonable that this is declared a protrusion because it's not. And the courts will have a different point of view than the examiner. Okay? The examiners they use case law to give them guidance on how to do things, but if they're just being completely robotic and not looking at the thrust of the invention and not really applying it fairly, then that can be resolved during appeal. So, looks like I started the thought there and missed it. Decisions on patentability. Okay, so that's the same kind of thing. That's the that's that 102, 103. So if I'm running out of time on a patent and I need to get something out, I might stretch my broadest reasonable interpretation and give you a 102 rejection instead of taking the time to apply maybe the best rejection, which would require a further art search. I might apply just this. So does anyone know what a 102 rejection is by chance? Okay, a 102 rejection is when you have a single piece of art that is the same as your application. So that's a 102. It's a single reference. That is when it's not novel, okay? A 103 rejection is when they take either two or more pieces of plurality of art, or they take a single piece of art and then they apply some sort of case law that gives them a reason to modify your structure. So, for instance, you know, if you have a door, okay, somebody got a patent on a door with three hinges. You come in and you say, oh, okay, I'm going to add one more hinge to that system. Well, it's going to be hard to find a piece of prior art that to modify. It's going to be hard to find two pieces of art that you're going to be able to tie together to make that rejection. However, the courts have looked at, you know, a lot of cases and given examiners guidance on ways to do a rejection based on a single piece of art that uses some rationale. And so that's going to be a single reference 103. And so like a rationale for that would be, well, you add a fourth hinge, it doesn't change the function. It would be obvious to provide, you know, duplicates of this, you know, feature because it doesn't change anything. It's still secured at the top and the bottom and the middle, and if you add another one, it doesn't really change anything. However, if in your specification, you can give a clear reason as to why that fourth hinge is important, they're not going to be able to use that sort of case law modification rationale against you. And sorry if that's But anyway, what it comes down to is examiners are going to apply hard. Either it's you're not new, it's a 102, same exact dimension, can't get it, or they're going to use a 103, which is going to use two pieces of art that are, have a reason to put them together, or one piece of art has a reason to duplicate or make the size difference or optimize it, or you know, there's a myriad of reasons why they would obviously modify a reference without using evidence from another piece of art. A piece of art is anything. It's a another patent, it's a publication, it's anything they find. So if you're trying to claim this pointer thing, and you're trying to claim this part is separate from this part, even though they screw together, if you say, an examiner come and say, well, even though you're saying, you know, I want to do this in two parts, and the prior art only has it as one part, you know, the examiner's going to say, it would be obvious to modify this thing to make that and that integral because it doesn't have any function, doesn't change anything. You know, unless you say it screws you with a battery, then it changes it. But if it's just, you're just saying, hey, I'm going to make it one part instead of two, or two parts instead of one, you know, those are both modifications that are obvious. You know, you can't go and steal somebody's idea and just say, hey, I want to just make it out of one piece instead of two. That doesn't work. And there's, like Roger said, there's a big list of, and their KSR rationales is a good search term. On Google to read about those. And then BD versus complexity. You know, I had guns and ammo that was pretty dialed in. There's a lot of different stuff coming out with business methods, and they have huge BDs. They have a disposal rate that 40 hours is what they have to do a patent. Okay, and it's wildly different. Sometimes you'll get a business method patent that has 200 pages of information, and it is a bear. And they will spend all of those 40 hours, if not a lot more, getting through it. Or they might get a business methods patent that is just an absolute slam dunk rejection. And I can knock it out in an hour, and I've got 39 hours to make up my time on these other ones that are harder. So that's kind of how the BD system works, and that's how they justify it. Lou, you can come on in. So just remember, you know, all examiners are different. Get to know them, get to learn their style. Some are more hardcore at rejecting than others. I was more of a liability person. Honestly, when I was going through your applications, doing my prosecution, I was keeping notes of what elements I wasn't seeing. And those patentable elements I had in my notes. And if you were to ask me, or if I was, you know, I would tell you if I thought about it, but you know, during interviews, you know, to ask, like, how can I make this patentable? How can I get around this prior art? And they will tell you, like, they want you to get a patent. It's not all about rejection. That's not what the patent office is for. We're here to advance the art. Let's see here, okay. So that's just the differences in examiner, so just keep that in mind. When it comes to helping your examiner, so like I said, examiners like getting disposals. We get 2 counts. If I get a first action disposal, I get 2 counts right off the bat. No seconds, no second non-final, no anything. It's just very quick. So I would spend 12 hours doing my cases. First action, if I get it out in first action, that's 6 hours to only use on another shot. So we like allowability. And like I said, you know, you're going to be working with the same examiner usually on all of the continuations in the part that apply to your application. So if you get a patent and you're you're gonna apply another patent based on some of the technology in there, then you're gonna have that same exam working with you. So keep that in mind. And even if you have a lawyer, you need to review the pro se materials they have online with the PTO. That'll give you a great foundation to understand the patent process, you know, what another perspective on what an examiner does, resources for finding lawyers. It's just, the PTO has some really good resources, so check that out. You need to learn everything you can about that process to make it as efficient and effective as possible. So learning how to use the MPEP, learning what the sections are, you know, reviewing applicable training online. There's a lot of resources for patentability training, whether that's search strategy, whether that's, you know, a nice summary of a particularly hard part of law. There's a lot of resources online. I've got some that I'll show you in a few more slides. And then, you know, learning how to search and stuff. So all those things, like just learning those things and having that background is going to allow you to write a much better patent application. You're going to have a lot better questions for your lawyer. You're going to give them a lot better material to work with. And if you go the pro se route, what you give to the patent office is going to have a lot better chance of getting through the system. So definitely get online and do some research. Make sure you work really closely with your lawyer. So give them all the information you can. So the more information in your specification, the better. It's not only going to allow you to write continuation patents on other inventions that are inside that disclosure, but it's also going to prevent other people from getting patents that are going to go directly against yours. So if you give specific examples of how your patent could be used in different ways, when somebody else comes along and says, hey, I have a patent that's just like this guy's, and if you said the application that he says in his patent, that gives the examiner a great 102, a great single source reference so they can do that rejection. And that's going to stand up very well in court, and it's better protection for you. It's protection that's outside of your claim set, which is the primary source of protection. Let's see here. So ensure the application makes sense. So make sure to review your stuff from your lawyer. They're busy. They have a docket just like the examiner, so they probably got 10 hours allotted to work on your case. And if you give them a piece of garbage, he's going to spend that whole 10 hours trying to get it into shape and then not have a lot of time to work on your claim set. So the better piece of, you know, the better specification and disclosure you give to your lawyer, the more time they're going to allocate towards drafting the claims. And I would assume, is that how that works? I mean, do you have, if somebody comes up to you and says, you know, here's this application, are you going to say, okay, I'll give it 10 hours? Or, I mean, when it comes to charging, if they give you a better piece of, a better specification, would that necessarily bring about a lower cost?
Yeah, I mean, I usually just get napkins and sketches. Like a legal description of for competitors. Legally, it has nothing to do with what you make. You don't have to make what's in a patent. You don't have to do anything. Patents strictly issue against your competitors. So the claims need to be written to thwart competitors. This is the most difficult part. You've got to, like, kind of envision how's a competitor going to try to get around my patent. I need to cover that. What's commercially important? And how are they going to manufacture, distribute, and sell? So if you really want to help a patent attorney, you want to think of these deals about, play devil's advocate and think about, if my product commercially succeeds, what are my competitors going to do? And that's what the patent has to make difficult. That's the hardest part.
Yeah, but you can really help out the lawyer by providing a nice fat specification that gives them a lot of options. So when they're trying to draft those claims to define that boundary, if they run into a piece of prior art that they're going to infringe on, they can change how they go about defining that boundary if you give them the information in that specification.
And then the one tricky part of the patent, once you file it, cast in concrete. You cannot add anything. So we can amend the claims. We can amend the claims, but the changes we make have to already be somewhere in that patent. So, like Adam said, if that description is, you know, bigger and more detailed, then we have more things to pull from. So I tell people, you know, even like if this was an invention, I would envision this patent having at least 10 figures and probably 30 pages of text. And most inventors, I think, would, they'd probably throw in a provisional, be one or two pages.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you can go on and on about options and materials and methods of construction, and there's all these things. So you have this bigger base of data to pull from.
So it's diagrams and descriptions? Or?
Yes.
Yeah, and it's like this, you know, how many ways can I describe this? Well, there's a physical structure to it, and I'm not going to talk much about the function of it, because that doesn't help patentability would be limited. But I can talk about the method of manufacturing this. I can maybe talk about the method of using this. So there's some derivatives we can
do. How does the function limit it?
Well, like if I was really going to claim this broadly, I'd probably say it has a base and a surrounding sidewalk standing on the base. And I would say all I can say functionally is it probably divides one volume from another volume.
Nice.
And that's it. But that's still physical, structural. I don't say it holds a drink. I don't say it holds a wood.
Right.
I don't say it holds a hot drink. Because
you don't say it's flat.
Right. If I say it's a sidewall, it can be squared.
So this gives me a good.
But just thinking of uses of this, how many uses are there? It's infinite. So I don't want to like tie down. And
you don't want to dilute it with all that.
Yeah.
Like, and he's not gonna give you any credit on the patent. If I say what it's used for, that does not.
It does not. So those are all really good points. And so to kind of piggyback on that, when it comes to the specification, you need a reason for changing the shape or the size or whatever, the material properties. You need to say, hey, it can be made out of rubber because it's waterproof. You can make it between this height because of this reason. So you can't just say, hey, it's gonna be white, or you know, you can't make design choices. You can't bring in limitations that don't have a purpose. You can't just say the bullet is between this and that and not give me a reason why. You know, you need that in the specification. When it comes to the claims, because you know, the important part of the patent is that it's not just that you get those 20 years, it's that you are providing the information to the public about how to make, use, or apply your patent. And you have to sufficiently tell them how to use it. Otherwise, you know, just saying a specification, you know, a bullet that's this long and this high and made of this, what is that? How do I use that? Why is that important? You know, so you need that information to tell the public exactly what your invention is. You can't withhold information as a trade secret and still get a patent on it, is a good way to see that. But when it comes to the claims, he's right. You don't get a patent based on what it's for. And in fact, when I was doing patent prosecution, if it said, you know, a bullet for, I would cross out everything after for so that I make sure and didn't read those limitations into the claim. Okay? The only time that you would be able to do kind of a for situation is to put in language that actively claims it. So if you say, you know, a glove configured to fit on a hand, okay? So yes, it's kind of a for situation. However, saying that it's configured to means that there is structure there that is specific to a human hand. You know what I mean? So in that specification, that's when you're gonna say, you know, it's got four fingers, it's, you know, four fingers and a thumb, or it's got a single mitten or whatever. But that's really specific. Using those terms as, you know, configured for, adapted to, that's kind of more of an advanced topic. But just know that you can, you know, in means claims. There's a lot of different ways that you can do a claim set to kind of broaden things out, still actively claim it, but never is it just purely a use. Because you could use that cup to dish out water, you could use that cup to start a little fire that burns for a long time, because it's, you know, made out of styrofoam. You could use it for a million things. It doesn't matter what it's used for. Yeah. Use it for a teller. It doesn't matter. It really doesn't. Unless you say it's configured to be shot, and you tell me why that would be configured, how is it configured to accept a bullet, to catch a bullet, so you can reuse it. So it's made out of this material. So that's when you bring in actual positively claimed structure with kind of, you know, a, more of a use situation. And that's when your, you know, your lawyer's gonna come in, so, and they're gonna draft those claims to try to get it as broad as possible, but you need to have all that stuff in that specification that gives them that ammunition to write good claims and to respond to office actions and get you patentable material. But you could, if you needed to.
Yeah.
You'd have very, very, very small piece of property. You know, instead of a city block, like his analogy of real property, you know, it'd be more like a 1x1 square inch on this floor. You know, it might not be very powerful, but you could still get it. Anything is patentable. That's just something to keep in mind. You can patent anything. As long as you dive deep enough into the required limitations, you can get it. But competitors can get right around it. So that's why it's good to have broad claims. So make sure that you're aware of timelines. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No.
Okay. Make sure you're just aware of timelines. So especially if you're pro se, you're obviously going to have to respond to the office. 6 months. Every time you get something from the office, you got 6 months to get back to them. When it comes to your lawyer, just make sure that you're in the know on where they're at in the process, and because they're managing a docket as well. And so if they're getting it on the back burner, or they forgot about it, whatever. Just, you know, it's your responsibility. It's not anybody else's. This is your patent. You're the one that's paying for it. So make sure and just take ownership of it. And that's the big thing. You know, that's when it came to issues with applications. A lot of time it was just proofreading stuff, and I'm sure it was because it was a big application and they ran out of time. So since you're a vested party here, take the time to to take that, you know, thing that, you know, the Lord produced and proofread it and make sure it makes sense. And, you know, there are some complicated stuff, so you're going to have to ask some questions. And don't go messing with the format. So if you go and screw up the format and change things you shouldn't, just make comments, okay? Because you don't want to have them redo work, because then you'll have to pay for that too. So talk to your lawyer about what you could do. That's maybe a better way to do it. And then attend interviews if you can. It's just a good way to hear how the lawyer talks to the examiner and how they go back and forth. Make sure you don't say anything though, because it comes from a single point of contact. If the examiner asks you questions, don't shoot yourself in the foot and say, "Oh, I invented this 3 years ago," because you only have 1 year in the time you invent this thing and, you know, lock it in with, you know, a prototype or whatever. So just make sure you don't, you know, disclose that this is an old thing or that it's an obvious variant of some other thing, or, you know, because they will write that down and they will do a rejection based on your interview and you saying something wrong. So talk to your lawyer, and it's best to be easy and not say so much. And ask questions. Don't shoot yourself in the foot. Don't divulge information. Don't disclose information to the public without an NDA. Like Roger said, the contract's going to lock you in, and they're not going to be able to use a private communication as a piece of prior art. However, if you're just throwing it out there to everybody, then they can. You know, if you go to a trade show and you tell everyone about it, and the guy at the trade show goes to a convention and says something about it, puts it in a PowerPoint presentation, and that was 2 years ago, then they're going to use that PowerPoint presentation against you. Because you disclosed it, and this is old art, and so they can use it. You have 1 year from when you disclose that in an eligible way for a patent examiner to use it against you, 1 year to get that patent. Okay, so if you put it on the internet that you made this new thing and it's cool and it's whatever, you got 1 year. So just keep that in mind. Let's see here. Let's see. And if you have something online right now, I suggest you delete it. Know your timelines when you got to submit stuff, and don't disclose obvious variants. Just because you have a patent pending on something doesn't mean, "Hey, yeah, like, I just had a thing. Oh, I thought of this other cool idea for it too." If it's not in your original provisional application, then that's not covered. So if you're disclosing obvious variants, there's no reason somebody else couldn't take that, go get a patent on it, and then you're out of luck. And even if you think they're obvious variants, I'm sorry. If you think that it's an obvious variant, maybe it's not. And somebody else is going to take that intellectual property and run with it. So just be really careful, even if you're in patent pending status. So in a nutshell, here's some helpful resources for you. You have the USPTO, great source of information, all sorts of training, all sorts of information. You have the EPO, which is your European website. They have the same information. They use different laws and rules. However, when it comes to searching classifications and other things, a lot of it carries over. WIPO, that's a source, and you can find applications at this site, so for prior patents. So if you're having issues finding a good English version of something, go there. WIPO is another great source. That's for international applications. That's another great source for like English. So is WIPO available? They'll give you a list of applications that go with a particular international application. So you can usually find an English version of patents in Japanese, you know, because you want to find the art. So that's just a source. And they also have great information on all sorts of stuff. Japanese patent office as well. These are pretty much, when it comes to examination search, when it comes to patentable stuff, like when I'm going to apply patents against your patent, these are the only places I'm going to look. So Google does a good job of rooting through there, but this is going to be my source to determine if you're novel or not obvious. You have the manual patent examination procedure. Basically, this is everything an examiner does in a nutshell. All the training, everything they do is based on this document. It's huge and pretty complex, but just take a look, do some, learn how to search it, learn how to look, learn what the main headings are. You don't have to memorize everything. understand just what it means to have a patent. Okay, there's a lot of examiner guidance and training materials that are on the PTO website. So when it comes to really good condensed information, you can find it. Okay, so if you want to learn about 102 law, which is the application of the single piece of art to prove that you're an hour, you can go on there and find some training slides that they use in the patent training academy to teach examiners that don't know anything about patents yet how to apply 102 art. So those training materials will give you a really nice condensed look, and they keep them all up to date. So that's important. It's very clear, it's concise, updated regularly. Pro se resources, go on here, and that's just the base area for pro se to get a look. Pro se means by yourself. It's the Latin word, by oneself, or something along those lines. Essentially, you don't lawyer. So you're doing this by yourself. So there's special rules and laws and ways that examiners are going to deal with you if you don't have a lawyer. And that includes help on prosecution. There's also a special division within the PTO that does nothing but pro se. And they are very experienced examiners and will be very helpful when it comes to writing claim sets. So I can't promise anything because they have a certain number of people they take on. As for 2015, they were full very early in the year, but it is something that's out there. I don't know how you get into there. You probably have to submit a petition or submit something to get into this pro se art group that will do any art. There's such good examiners that they can do any art, and so you'll go over there and they'll hold your hand, basically. And a lot of times you write your claim sets with the examiner amendment. That's a risk. It's always a risk to go alone, because you never know, you could shoot yourself in the foot. End up with a really hard examiner, not get any pro se help, and have terrible claims, and then you're hosed. Let's see here. Okay, helpful websites. Another resource, look at these. So these are the sections of the law that I recommend you look at. On a base level, you can understand these. 102, 103, 112. And so 101 and 112 are more based on non-art, so that's more, is it one of the four statutory categories of invention, and not a judicial exception. You have 112, which is basically, is your claim set nonsensical? Are there errors in it? Is there a lack of an antecedent basis? Is it just confusing? Things like that. So that's more proofreading and being able to understand a claim set. 102 or 103 are when you bring in art rejections. So how is 102 applied? A single reference? What are the timelines for them to use a particular piece of art? Same with 103, how do they apply obviousness? How do they apply modification rationale if it's a single reference? How do they apply case law? So all those training materials are online. Just look for them. Either that or go to the MPP and look at that. Some examples of some training info. There's really great guidance on one-on-one business methods on the PTO website. I don't know if any of you guys are doing anything complicated like that, but essentially business method is a method of business. It's a process with fine steps that includes computers or dozens or special things. But it has to be, it has to be certain criteria so that it's not seen as like an abstract idea or all these other things. So anyway, good reference there for that kind of stuff. The EPO has some good search training there. Google Patents is great. Great source for figuring out how class systems work. Classifications is the most important thing when it comes to searching. Okay, you're going to make an invention, you're going to have a claim set, and you're going to see that, you're going to recognize that your claim set is directed to a certain type of invention, whether that's a screw, like a thing, elongated member that attaches two things, or whether that's an ammunition, or whether that's whatever it is, that invention is going to fall in classification. That broadest invention is going to fall into a class. So you need to know what class applies in order to do an effective search. Okay. For instance, if I was doing, and you can see them online, the class classifications are very, very, very accurate. So it's, it'll be, and I keep going back to bullets because that's what I was doing, you know, it'll be, you know, you'll go very far down the rabbit hole all the way to bullets that are non-leaded, frangible, and, you know, have special aerodynamic properties. So that would be one classification. And you go in there, and there's only 60 patents in there, and you're able to really look at the state of the art for just bullets that are this and that and this and that. So try to think about your invention, and then you can just type classification search on the internet, and it'll take you to it. WIPO, it's a great source for patent searching as well. I really like WIPO. Hard to find information is living in there. And then patent forums are another great way. If you're really interested in getting into the patent ballgame and just understanding intellectual property, you can hit up just a number, do a Google search on, you know, patent blogs, and you'll come up. Patentio is huge, IP Watchdog, IPCAD, these are all really big ones. There's a bunch of other ones out there. We'll have, you know, threads, they'll have information there. You can search for information. If you want to learn about something, there's a wealth of information out there. It's just a little bit hard to sift through. So just know what you're looking to learn and hone in on it. Because there's not a ton that's going to apply to a simple mechanic patent. You know, 102, 103, 112. You don't even really need to know 101 because it's a mechanical patent. They're not even going to apply it. So anyway, and you can learn that. If you know, I'll try to do a mechanical patent on this. You'll find a source that says, you know, what you should do. And with that, I know there's a ton of information, but do you guys have any questions, general, specific, about an exam, about how the process works?
Sure.
If you have a patent that has software and hardware,
mm-hmm.
Say the hardware is not new, it's not the system, but you have created a couple of software programs.
Mm-hmm.
How do you represent the code? I got different answers from different people.
I would look at the MPEP. I wasn't a software guy, so I don't know necessarily the structure that you would need to do for a claim set. And since I don't know the structure for a claim set, I don't know what you're going to need to put in that specification. I do know that you can't do, you can't do a mathematical equation by itself. You know, if you bring in a mathematical equation in a new way that's substantially different than the traditional use, then you can get around, and that would be like a one-on-one issue. But I don't know, Roger, can you talk more about the software stuff?
So the software, there is sometimes you need to include what the software runs on. That's what you're talking about. But typically not, because that's a narrowing thing. You know, the software, we think of it as a step-by-step process. So if you want to keep the patent as political and flexible and huge as you can, you don't want to tie it down to the hardware. Because if an infringer in the future is running on different hardware, you want to be able to cover whatever that is. So that's one aspect of it, although that can help compatibility. If you're running some very unique hardware, possibly. But, you know, you don't say, I run the software on, you know, a computer, a processor, use memory, because those are such generic terms now.
One person said you have to get the source code and provide it.
Yes and no.
Another person said you just do a schematic,
flowchart.
Flowcharts are common. So here's the deal. I try to force clients into doing source code because, again, that makes the spec more included in detail. So include the source code, which is in the form of an ASCII 2 file. It's not mandatory by the patent office, though. Because people will do software patents without it. Now, why would you do that? Well, sometimes there's a part of an invention they want to keep trade
Oh, go ahead, I'm sorry.
Example, I can't have my dad be doing anything. Boise was mass science acceleration because it's applicable to all kinds of results. But if I had an equation that relates to, say, computer control of molding a material for a specific part, that's the dynamic.
Yeah, yeah, the standard.
That's a specific application, so that will.
Can't preempt people from using.
Yeah.
So like an equation, 1 + 2, or A + B equals C, like that's a fundamental way that things are calculated. It's also a way that someone can do with a pen and paper. So that's not patentable. It's when you start applying, like Roger said, this particular equation to a mold manufacturing situation where this is what the structure of the apparatus is, and it uses these variables with that equation to open the thing or apply some solvent at a particular time, that's when you start to get away from preempting people from using the equation A+B and get into using the equation A+B with a very specific apparatus causing a transformation. You have a very specific use. So you're not preempting people. You actually have an invention. It's substantially more than the judicial reception of a mathematical equation.
Depends on the art unit. We were at 75 for guns and ammo. 75% approval. I really recommend, so on that presentation where I had had listed the resource for 101, you should really go in there and look at subject matter eligibility and really look into, there's probably 100 pages of stuff that you could read, but it'll give you a really good idea of how you need to, what information you need to have in your specification to really delineate your invention from just, the standard use of, an abstract idea. So like you're trying to use an algorithm to do something, I'm assuming this software thing, you need to talk about, what it is that software works with. What's the hardware? Is that hardware a thing that provides wireless capability where there wasn't before? And that function in itself is a special thing. And, once you get past that, the receiving antenna that gets that information and how it processes it, and does it provide it into a web page so that people can access it in a special and unique way? So those are all process steps that you can add invention into this to make the case that, hey, this isn't just an ineligible abstract idea, like this is true hardware, and this is truly substantially more. That's the key word. You have to be substantially more than just, the natural phenomenon.
Say
the, can't claim freezing ice, but you can claim something that includes freezing ice.
The software has to have an end result of an action taken. So I know some abstract, maybe some examples. If I had a system that calculated a credit rating,
And to piggyback on that, so a good kind of way to think of it, and this is also kind of another buzzword that you'll see in this eligibility training and stuff, is that the examiner needs to take into account not just that particular, you know, ineligible thing, an equation. They can't just take into account the equation when determining if this is eligible or not. They have to take into account the entire claim, and the entire claim includes the combination of all the things that you've included, so the structures of physical items doing work and the inclusion of particular process steps that are doing work, and it has to take them in consideration in a particular order. Okay, so the combination and in a particular order. So even though you're dealing with kind of ineligible software, algorithms or whatever, as long as you've got a sufficient combination and sufficient order to make that thing a unique, substantially different thing than what they would reject, then that's how you get around 101. And that's, let me say that, that's just getting around 101. Once you're around, 101 is basically, are you an eligible category? Are you a machine? Are you a process? Is your invention a machine? Is your invention a process? Is your invention a combination of matter, or a composition of matter? You know, those, if you venture into the world of abstract ideas and judicial exceptions, so that's another buzzword, if you venture into those, into that world, then you need to provide a lot more information so that you can get status of patent eligibility. And once you're eligible, that's when you kick into the system and they'll do their prosecution. That's when they'll do their art search. That's when they'll go looking for it. But you have to get over 101 before they'll do any work. Okay? And like I said, your specification needs to have a lot of examples and a lot of things for your lawyer to work with. Because if you only give them one option of how this works, that's all you're going to get. And if that's not going to get over 101, you're hosed. So you need to provide as many alternatives as possible for kind of abstract idea stuff, marketing strategies, let's see here, ways to, you know, organize data and, you know, interpret it. You know, just general, you can't take a spreadsheet and patent it. Everyone does that. You need it for business. So just figure out how you're going to use it. Yeah, go ahead, Jim. Mm-hmm.
A lot of general things and background and all that.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you get to the claims, you're assuming they've read all of that, or you're, that that all fits. So
mm-hmm.
you're just making a little short claim.
Yeah. Yeah, you're condensing it.
So you want to be limiting?
No. So where the limitations come in is your attorney or you or whoever, you're going to look at what you have in your specification. You know, you're talking about a cup. You're gonna say, okay, broadest way I can do that, I did a search, I'm not seeing anything that's a tapered cylinder with a closed bottom end. Didn't see anything in the world of art on that. So you're gonna have that as a claim. It's gonna kick back because the examiner's gonna find that cup. And then you're gonna say, oh, okay, well, shoot. Maybe, okay, so he presented this art of this cup. Well, oh, if I change it and put the taper outwards, then that would still work for what I want to do, but the examiner is going to say, well, that's a whole different embodiment. That's something new. You can't add new matter into this application and get that new priority date. That just doesn't work like that. You can't add new matter. So you need to get as much in that specification you can, so when you get rejected on a tapered cylinder with, you know, an acute angle relative to the surface it sits on, you know, configured to sit on the surface with an acute, you know, angle of taper, you know, if that gets blocked, but you have in your specification that it could be obtuse as well, then your lawyer on the second round of prosecution can introduce that to a certain extent, because there's a thing called, by original presentation, election by original presentation. So you can't go switching inventions completely during prosecution. You have to be, but that's a whole other topic. Yeah, but you could do a divisional, you could do a continuation, and you could still get that priority date in some way if you just include all the ways that you could build this thing in your original embodiment, in your original disclosure. So the disclosure is your specification, drawings, claim set. So that's just kind of a word to have in mind, but
that original specification, have all those variants, and pictures are truly worth a thousand words. Okay, so as many pictures as you can do, because that cut, you're talking about it. To me, if I was examining a claim set and you introduced, if you didn't talk about a particular element well enough or something, as long as that drawing has that lip in it, you know, you could make a case for, you know, I put that lip in there, you know, for a function. And so just, and that's the other thing, in your claim set, you know, when you're claiming things, you need to have your claimed limitations in your drawings to do as best as possible, as best as it makes sense. If you're claiming a handle in your claim set, but you don't have a drawing of a handle, the thing with a handle, they're going to kick you back and say, we want new drawings that show a handle. And make sure that handle that you put in there is in line with your specification. However, that's a slippery slope because a drawing is worth 1,000 words. And so if you send in something that's not exactly like your specification, they might flag you from that, you know, oh, okay, it's round. You didn't say in the specification that it's a round handle. You just said it's a handle. Okay, so drawings are really good for getting a lot of limitations into a specification without a lot of words. So lots of embodiments. And be aware that you only get one invention per patent. So even though you get 16 different cups, as long as they aren't, if they require whole different searches, like an examiner has 18 hours to do one patent. So I'm going to look at one specific bullet. If you're trying to introduce another bullet that's completely different, a different classification, is going to require a completely different search. I don't have time to do that. And that's when what's called restriction practice comes in. Because you have two things that are not obvious variants, okay? And it's going to be a burdensome search, and I'm not going to be able to do all that work in this amount of time. But, you know, and the other thing you'll learn about the patent office is it's all very gray. It's up to the examiner to decide, do I restrict or do I not? Okay, so once again, get on the good side of your examiner, and they'll be good to you. You know, don't try to overload them with 700 inventions. You know, they'll get pissed and they'll shut down, and they will limit you to a single claim with restriction practice. It's easy to do.
I might add another. You were talking about versions, say, of 6 versions in the spec. You just claim one. But that can be a business strategy too.
Yeah, you can get them.
And on that, you can really, so when it comes to what's called restriction practice, and that's basically limiting to your patent to a single invention, if you submit something to me and I say I'm going to restrict this for whatever reason, because these are two different inventions, these are not obvious variants, okay? When it comes time and you restrict, you go with a single, you know, so each invention has 10 claims, you elect 1 through 10, 11 through 20 are non-elected, so they're not getting reviewed. When you come along and submit the divisional application for the invention living in claims 11 through 20, I am not going to say, I'm not as patent examiner going to be able to say that these are obvious variants of one another. So it gives you some protection on using inventions against one another, and it separates inventions so you can have multiple pieces of the property, and it makes it so they can't say, they can't say that you're double patenting, okay? So you can't receive two patents for the same thing, okay? And so, let me retract, the whole point of doing an intentional restriction is so that they can't say,
this and this patent is the same as that patent. Because you only, one patent can have one invention and it works the other way around. So, you know, you can't go get six patents for the same thing and have six pieces of intellectual property that overlap each other. You know, you as the inventor are entitled to your invention. However, you're not entitled to the six of the same invention that you can go sell to other people. Okay, so if they restrict it, they're not going to be able to say this is a double patenting issue. And so that's a pretty powerful thing down the line, especially if you're trying to do a piece of intellectual property that's going to split and be sold as, you know, or licensed or whatever. So that can kind of, so forget my whole obviousness argument that I was talking about. I was going down the wrong track. You know, that's double patenting protection. But there's, you know, there's, and that's a cool thing a lawyer can do is they can look at what you got and try to maximize your return. So
that's just a fraud prevention. People, if they have an invention that's doing good in the market and making money, people may be tempted to file later patents on because they want to stretch monopoly out of time. So that's how the patent office tries to catch that. Mm-hmm. Two patents are too close to each other, then you get caught in another patent.
Yep.
If they're just obvious to one another,
and the first thing an examiner does when they get an application is I do an inventor search, an assignment search, and a search of prior art that you listed in the information disclosure statement. So those three pieces of information, it's not much. It's just looking for your name, the name of the company you're working for, and the patents that you think are kind of applicable. I'm going to look at those three things, and a lot of times knock out a patent, either for double patenting or for, you give me an IDS with five good pieces of art, I'm not gonna limit my search to just those five pieces of art. I'm gonna look at that, those five pieces of art, anything that cited them or any art that they cited. So I'm gonna take those five pieces of art and I'm gonna turn them to 60. And I'm gonna find a lot of the art that reads on what you're doing. And from there I just, you know, do some really specific text modification techniques to figure out specific elements and if it makes sense to combine them. So anyway, they're gonna look for your name. So that's that restriction practice can be a powerful tool to prevent double patenting rejections. So anyway, that's 101 law as well. Do you guys have any questions about anything? Lots of strategy to doing your intellectual property.
There's also such things as a perfect patent, you know.
Right.
You'd be better. But in any case, you're generally better off with one than not, even an imperfect one. Because at least your competitors are going to like be thwarted. They're going to, well, they've got a patent on it. I guess if you're going to have to investigate it and check it out, we'd better find something to copy that is a patent. And I'll worry about it.
So anyway, on those spreadsheet or on those handouts I gave, I've got an email address on there. I do check that pretty regularly. If you have, you know, kind of a simple question, you know, where to search or something, I could help you. If it gets too crazy, I'd probably.
Is this the last one you sent me?
It's the last one that was saved. It's just. I think you can. I think you can do that. So anyway, yeah. Simple questions. Just let me know if you have something. I'm here for volunteer stuff. So. It's just more volunteer time, so just, I don't know, good luck, and just research and learn, and it's more simple than you think. If it makes sense, if this is something really unique, then it could be patentable. You know, if it's you just trying to play word games and semantics, trying to finagle intellectual property, that's not going to work. That's, as a rule of thumb, that's a good way to think about it. And I can't speak to the prior art that whatever your inventions are dealing with, because there's a lot of stuff out there. So even if you think you got a great idea, it might have been patented already in 1892. You know, there's patents that go way far back. Early 1800s is some of the stuff that I was doing for guns. You know, it's just learn how to search a little bit and get good resources and just take ownership. I think I'm giving the search class, actually.
Oh, I agree.
Yeah.
So that's at the Republic Library downtown, fourth floor, east end of the building. So this is all our parents are interested in getting the search class.
Yeah, and to speak to that, so it's going to be an they're setting up the east computers, right? A bank of them?
Yeah, we have computer training room.
Okay, so what that training is going to be on is how to use the program called EAST. Can't remember what it stands for, but basically it's the search tool that we patent in our shoes. And it's the most powerful tool when it comes to mechanical patents. It's not as powerful when it comes to squirrely ones like business methods and software, because they're very new and there's just not a lot of information. And the state of the art is more on Google than it is in the patent database. So EAST is going to be about classification searching, how you build a search strategy, how you build concepts that you think could be patentable elements, how you do search on them, and how you do text modification to really narrow in on specific stuff. And I think that you should definitely come to that, because it's an open resource at the Public Library, and you can really improve your quality of your product, whether you go pro se or you work with somebody like Roger. Anyway, that's, I guess, on the 16th.
It's only available at the library and patent office. It's a huge run-end system, so it's not available to you. Preliminary searching online, but that kind of searching you have to go there. It's probably beneficial because the people would help you.
Yeah.
You gotta spend time on
it. So much better than any, for certain types of patents, it's so much better than Google. If you're doing a mechanical thing, it's the perfect resource. Sure.
So if you find something that's similar, how different does your invention have to be? Because a lot of people say all you have to do is change one little item.
Depends on the art.
Huh?
It depends on the art. Okay, so if you're saying, hey, I got a gun and I want to put a different type of sight on it, does that kind of sight exist? Does it exist in combination? Do you see out there rationale of why one would modify it? You know, if you're trying to say a laser dot versus a hologram, you know, you can find information out there that's, hey, hologram and a laser sight, they perform the same function, it's the same thing. So I would do, personally, on a gun with a holographic sight, I would use a laser sight with evidence from some internet source that says, hey, holographic and laser, it's the same thing. And I would reject you based on that. So it's all dependent on what your art is and what the limitation change is, if they can apply a modification rationale to it. So it's best put in function when you're modifying, because then you can thwart efforts to reject using like KSR rationales. Okay, so yeah, that's definitely the resource. That's
but it's the in the patent world, we call 102, 103. That's really the differences between who say firearms, public domain, and what you're claiming. So how much differences there have to be.
Oh yeah, it'll give you a great feel.
Look, okay, I'm looking at patents and similar technology. You can look
Can you use Pear to look at other people's applications? You can, like, as a general.
It's published.
Okay, I didn't even know you could use. I thought Pear was just more for the inventor.
It's a great way to see all the correspondence.
It's a great way.
On the prosecution.
Yeah. To read how your inventor. Oh my gosh, that's. Yep. That's an amazing resource. And not just that, you can look and see how your examiner interprets broadest reasonable interpretation.
Yeah.
So by going in there and looking at how he prosecuted against claims, you can get a feel for, oh, this guy is a hard, hard person, you know, and that might give you some insight in where you're going to be able to go with this patent. You know, that's a great, I didn't know that you could do that.
Sure.
Public good. Well, I wonder if the office has, I wonder if the Denver office has access to pre.
They might, but it's just the point where they started scanning everything versus the old paper file rule. But if it's a really close application, certainly.
Yep. Yeah, definitely. Go look at two applications that are kind of in your ballpark, in the wheelhouse of your invention. If you're doing soap dishes, go look at two soap dish applications. Find the classification that your thing falls into with a Google search, okay? And then go look at that application history and look at everything that went back and forth between that person and the office. And you're going to see exactly how prosecution happens and how claims develop and how issues with unclear claim sets, issues with drawings being bad. You'll get a great feel for, you know, it'll give you a lot of foresight into what you're going to be embarking on.
Exactly. I have a software application and kind of a close application. It was actually from Microsoft. I went through and saw what they originally filed and got 100% rejection, and I saw the changes they made in the filing.
Yeah, you can see in those 2009 filed applications that didn't get approved until this January, you can see what they changed to make that language substantial in the case of, you know, your software changes. So anyway, that's all I really got. So I guess I'll see some of you on the 16th.
Yeah.